I just had a few thoughts I wanted to share in relation to health in the built environment. From a retrospective perspective, thinking a little bit about our past, our present, and where we're going in the future. So here in the last few months, we've been spending quite a bit of time talking about San Antonio's past. Of course, we were all really thrilled with the UNESCO designation of our Spanish colonial missions as World Heritage Sites. So here are a few photos that show some of those missions, as well as the Spanish governor's palace, just reflecting back on San Antonio's earliest days, what types of buildings were created, what the built environment was like, and we'll think and talk a little bit about the planning principles that resulted in this original built environment. So here on this slide, these are some of the old, very old plans that guided the creation of the early settlement here. And these plans were created based on these guiding principles established by the laws of the Indies, which the Spanish crown had developed back in the 16th century. So those laws address settlement, development, and administration of the Spanish colonies all throughout the world. And they are an example of one of the earliest codes addressing urban form. And we can see all throughout, not just the US, but the world, examples of cities where their original centers followed these codes. And we still see the impact here in San Antonio based on the location of our city, where our city actually started in our original urban form. So I think it's really important for us to reflect on that heritage in our the session that I was just in was on authenticity and in our neighborhoods and the built environment. And all throughout I kept thinking about history and how that plays a key role in authenticity. So we'll have the opportunity to celebrate that history in 2018 when we celebrate 300 years since the founding of our city. And as I mentioned, we've been designated a World Heritage Site, and Councilwoman Villagran has been leading a series of meetings regarding that designation and how it can impact, will impact the neighborhood where the missions reside and how we can work together in order to have a positive impact. So there certainly is an opportunity for us to recover that original heritage, which is authentically San Antonio, and we can use that as a springboard to build a city grounded in the local environment and its resources. And so looking a little more closely at those laws of the Indies, which take us back to the conversations we're having today. So back in the 16th century, they were thinking about environmental health as the laws focused on clean air and water, the prevailing winds and designs of buildings to capture those. They addressed urban design of the size of streets, sidewalks, porticos and plazas, where commercial districts would be located. They had standards related to parks and open space, which were reflected through their description on where social gatherings could occur. And they also had architectural standards that referred to the sake of the beauty of the town. And they also planned for growth. They didn't just assume that what they originally set up would remain static. And also, the laws included a street grid that would facilitate transportation. And these are just some quotes from those laws of the Indies. Commons would be outlined large enough that if there's expansion, there'd be sufficient space where people could go for recreation. And then there's a discussion or description of the plaza, how the street should be laid out. Reference to merchants, economic activity, and porticos and sidewalks, all things that are extremely relevant today. So, unfortunately, in those 300 years since the our original city form was created in compliance with those laws of the Indies, we have veered from that path, and that has resulted in many of our contemporary health challenges. Americans not meeting the recommended minimum for physical activity, health outcomes for minority and lower income population being worse than average outcomes, and a lot of that has to do with poor planning decisions and citing noxious uses in neighborhoods where people did not have a voice in the political process. We've also focused on economic development, sometimes to the point where we have threatened the quality of our air and our water. And then when we talk about health, we usually focus on physical health, but I'm sure there are some mental health advocates in the room as well, and that studies have shown that depression and other mental health issues can be exacerbated by lack of exercise, by not being exposed to the great outdoors. And then also the inability to drive can result in lack of access to goods and services. And we see in not just San Antonio, but in other cities as well, income segregation and actually ability segregation. People are not physically able to participate fully in life because they cannot get to the resources that would allow them to do so. Now, we all know how we got there. That cities, unfortunately, have been designed for cars and not for people. Actually, even to the point, to the micro level of homes actually even being designed for cars and not people. I had a friend visit from Virginia, and we were driving around. She was accompanying me to some meetings, and we were driving around some of the more suburban areas of San Antonio, and she said to me, "What's up with these car houses?" All the houses have front-loading garages. What's up with that? I don't know. But so everything revolves around automobiles since the rise of the automobile. And so here's a quote. What really happened was that the eye level stuff was handled by traffic engineers, and they are the ones, we allowed them to shape our environments in our cities. In 50 years, nobody has systematically looked after a good urban habitat for Homo sapiens. So really, we've gotten a little bit distracted. We got away from those original principles that worked really well over 300 years ago and established the basis for our thriving community that now we obviously need to go back to and think about, you know, how we've gotten off track, but also how we can incorporate those modern advances like the automobile. So we're at a critical transition point, and we have the opportunity to pivot from development that's just dependent on the automobile to pedestrian, bicycle, and transit playing a role in design. One of the most important conversations that we can have, and especially as someone who is elected and who is often challenged on, you know, efficient use of our taxpayer dollars, one of the most important conversations we need to have is about how we can move from expensive infrastructure that is built to serve just one purpose to instead thinking about multiple purposes for our urban infrastructure. And I have an example to show you of that in just a moment. We need to pivot the conversation here in San Antonio from economic development just being defined as creating jobs and retaining jobs to instead thinking about and recognizing the role of the parks, the arts, and other areas in economic growth and development. And a large reason for that is because those of you in the room that are under 40, and I'm not in that category, but for those of you that are younger, many times you're making decisions about where to live and work on issues and assets beyond just the availability of a job. You're making decisions about the type of lifestyle that you want to have, and we want to be able to retain and attract that talent here in San Antonio. So we have to have a much broader view of economic development, because as the last bullet shows, instead of workers following jobs, now we have a scenario where jobs are following workers. Now here's an example of one of the points that I wanted to demonstrate to you. How many of you have seen this in San Antonio, at least in 10 different places? It serves a purpose, okay? And when we look again back at our history, I'm sure that there are some folks in the room who could share more detail than me on the legacy in many of our communities, the death toll as a result of flooding and lack of infrastructure. So certainly this has served a purpose to facilitate the flow of water away from our intersections. But wouldn't you prefer this, which allows that same purpose to be accomplished, moving the water, but also provides an opportunity for people to recreate, for people to be active, to connect different parts of town to each other. We have this opportunity here in San Antonio. I was very excited that the voters in May approved our recommendation to increase the dollars that are allocated to the Howard Peak Greenway Trails Program. I think that is one of the underutilized assets that we have here in our city. And I actually think only a small number of San Antonians actually realize that we have that system and that there's the potential for it to for us to build on that and expand it to connect neighborhoods, to provide opportunities for recreation and access to people in different parts of town to the natural environment. So I think we really, especially as we venture onto this conversation about the possibility of a $750 million bond proposal. I don't know if you all had heard that. Earlier this morning, someone showed the pie chart that showed how much of the bond had gone towards streets and that kind of infrastructure, and that was $596 million from 2012. But right now, we're looking at the possibility of being able to spend $750 million for a bond in 2017. And so in order to get, even that sounds like a lot of money, but believe me, once everybody comes up with the different projects and we look at what the need is throughout the city, it gets divvied up pretty quickly. So thus, we need to really think about multi-purpose infrastructure. And no insult to some of the traffic, to the TCI folks that are in the room, because I know you're in here, but we cannot let them drive the discussion on how to spend the $750 million. The rest of us have to be engaged in the conversation, and we have to push them to think beyond whatever that single purpose might be, whether it's moving water or moving cars for our infrastructure investment. We have to have multiple purposes for the infrastructure that we'll be building with that money. So I'm going to be calling on everyone in this room to be part of that discussion. And I truly hope that you are also engaged in the SA Tomorrow planning process, because rather than just having a fight where we all duke it out, where, you know, the squeaky wheel or the best organized group gets the money, let's come together as a community around a vision that reflects the goals that we want to achieve, one of which is to be a healthier environment. And let's let that drive, you know, how we allocate those dollars. So that's part of your homework when you leave here today. So in thinking about the future, here's a bit of irony for us. You know, everyone's talking about technology and how that allows us the freedom to be anywhere, work anywhere. But according to Bruce Katz in the Metropolitan Revolution, there is a deep irony in the fact that technology, which was supposed to cut the ties between people and places and allow people everywhere to work from almost anywhere, turns out to flourish in fairly compact geographic locations. And so we need to keep that in mind as we think about our future for our community, how we want to grow and develop, that as we harness the technology that is being refined each and every day, that we want to ensure that we do create a physical environment here that will optimize its usage. So that was all kind of opening commentary for this afternoon's lunch plenary on downtown San Antonio, which, again, our downtown was founded and started based on those principles from 300 years ago, the laws of the Indies that worked so well. We have the opportunity before us today to focus specifically in that area in building the kind of community that attracts residents and enables them to lead healthy lives. And we can make investments there that leverage existing public infrastructure as opposed to some areas where we'd be starting from scratch. And as many of you know, downtown models are quite livable. They provide a sustainable lifestyle that can be replicated in other neighborhoods. Now, let me just say, I feel like I have to give a caveat that one of the advantages to me of life in San Antonio is that you can live within the city limits and there are a variety of neighborhoods and lifestyles that you can enjoy within our San Antonio city limits. But so if you like driving everywhere and you know, that kind of thing, hey, that's fine. You may not be as healthy, which that's what we're talking about here today. But I think certainly it is critical that we offer, that we continue to offer that diversity of lifestyles and that we should not favor one over the other. And so that's why it's incumbent upon us to look at where we already have significant investments, especially in infrastructure, in those older style neighborhoods that do allow us to accomplish many of these objectives that we're talking about as far as a healthy lifestyle, in investing in those so that we can have a more vibrant downtown, vibrant adjacent neighborhoods, and growth here in our city that spreads out from the core. So, gives you a little bit to think about. The next portion of the program.